Hi and welcome to Insight's Industry Immersion Series. In this series, you will meet data scientists from all across the world as they come and discuss what's trending in the data science and AI space. Let's begin today's episode of Industry Immersion with yet another speaker.
What are the semantics behind that particular word or the semantics behind that particular sentence? So that was kind of one of those pivotal moments that really got me excited about the field that I was in.
Awesome. So you just realized during that moment that computers can see and computers can talk.
Absolutely. Just like humans. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So I think, this is actually a defining moment for a lot of people, especially people who are working with deep learning, that you can actually see certain things which are human-like. Computers seeing objects and identifying them. Computers seeing text and replying to them. So these are like very human-oriented interactions. And that is one of the most defining moments, just like Akshay had, even I had something very similar. And all of you, I believe, friends, now close to 300 participants, Akshay, I think you can see it on your screen. So
awesome.
I think a lot of people are indeed looking up to learn a lot of things from you today. So yeah, friends, so the defining moment is always when you see computers behaving like humans, that is where we start thinking, okay, this thing is so powerful. So beautiful, Akshay. So having said that, you started off early with data. You got into Mu Sigma, probably one of the best companies to be in the data science space.
Yes.
You moved on to starting a company of your own, right? So as a co-founder, you would have faced a lot of challenges, right? So what were the challenges that you as a co-founder faced in the data science space, at least in India?
Sure. When I was working in Mu Sigma, the problem statements that we used to get were very structured, right? It was our objective to really solve the problem, but the problem itself was very structured and it was really thought through because the client was already paying for it. When I started off my startup, one of the first things that I realized was that, being a data scientist is obviously not enough. You have to wear multiple hats. You have to understand, cross domain, you have to do hiring, you have to do management, you have to, do pre-sales, sales, marketing, all that stuff has to happen while being a data scientist who's solving the problem. So that was the first thing that I think, one of the first challenges that, I faced. In terms of the work that I did, it was the first time where I realized that in order for you to really, really justify what you're trying to do and explain what you're trying to do from machine learning perspective, because you would probably just have a demo or a POC, right? You have to make sure that the client that you're trying to sell the product to or the idea to really understands what you're trying to do. This is the first time where, we had to really understand how do you take a very complex mathematical idea and turn it into an intuitive explanation for the client so that they can understand, a non-technical client, a non-technical leader can understand, what we are trying to achieve and be very confident about our capability. That was the kind of the second challenge. And I think one more challenge that I can think of right now is data science as a domain is very research oriented. Research takes a lot of time. However, when you're working in a startup, you're looking at a very quick implementation or you're trying to follow leads very, very quickly as soon as possible and close POCs very quickly. So the balance between a research or inspired domain and a very fast paced delivery domain was another challenge that I realized was something that you have to face when you're working as a co-founder or you're starting a data science company.
Awesome. So if I were to summarize it, and correct me if I'm wrong anywhere, first things first is it's not about you being lucky enough to get awesome data every time. You got to fight
Absolutely.
It out. You got to fight it out each day to get the best data possible or make the best out
Absolutely.
Of what you have, right? That would be
Absolutely.
My first consideration. The second consideration is you might be an awesome techie, you might be an awesome statistician, you might be an awesome business person, but at the end of the day, you have to simplify things so that customers can understand.
Right. You have to wear that hat of a sales guy.
Yeah. So you have to make it as layman as possible. And the third thing which I understand is being in a corporate, being in a startup, and not being in academics, the challenge for everybody is you got to get your output ASAP. You cannot wait for research to become 100% accurate and then you come up with the idea, right?
Yeah, yes. You have to leverage everything that is out there without trying to reinvent everything from scratch because you won't
have time. You don't have to be 100% accurate. Whatever you are, get it up and running and then improvise.
Yes, absolutely.
Right? So wonderful. I think three very important insights, friends. I think all of you should keep a note of these three points. Never are you going to get best possible data. Never ever try to be too techie or too non-techie in data science. You have to be a balance because at the end of the day, you have to understand the idea behind data science, but you have to explain it to the customer in English, in simple English. And the third thing is, don't try to become 100% accurate. Nobody's perfect. You cannot become perfect. You don't have to become perfect, but you have to try to achieve to become perfect. So keep improving over a period of time. Beautiful insights from Akshay. Moving on to the next one. So moving on to the next question, since you say that you've got to kind of get excellence every day, there should be some kind of best practices that leaders would want to follow to get to achieve this, the best possible outcome, best possible product in this space. So what are your best practices that you have learned out of your experience?
Sure. So in terms of the process flow for machine learning, it's not very complicated. There's something known as CRISP-BM. You can Google search it probably later. But it's a very standard model that you follow where you're talking about the iterations between the business understanding and your problem understanding. Then there are iterations of, between the exploratory data analysis and the model building, the deployment, and that kind of turns into a circle that you follow. So you don't really need to have a very strong, follow a very strong, a process flow. But I think leaders need to start treating teams, data science teams and AI teams more, not as development teams, but more as research/creative teams. And now this is something that, I've heard very few people talk about this. And this is something that I really believe is very important because a data science team at the end of the day is a creative team. Unlike a development team where you would be providing the team members exactly what needs to be done. You need to create a function that takes in this and gives out this. A leader would not be providing a data science team where, I need exactly this. They would be talking about a much more abstract problem statement. How do I increase my sales in this department? How do I invest my money in these particular channels? It's the job of the data scientist to be creative and as much research oriented as possible to really get and get into the depth of the topic that is being talked about and design a solution that solves the problem, the business problem at the end of the day. So treating a data science team as a creative team is a very good thing because creative teams, you would usually know that they're given a lot of space, a lot of freedom of tools to work with. Their objectives are very clear and very abstract, but there is a lot of freedom of different approaches that they can take. And that to me, I believe is one of the best approaches of how leadership should tackle and work with data science teams. The other thing that I see is a lot of standardization of practices. Standardization of tech stacks and libraries is done nowadays. That you have to write the code in Python, deploy it in Django, and so on. So that's fine when you're looking at a final product, a production grade deployment. But if you start doing that before, you're kind of limiting the capability of the data scientists. So you should never do that. Give them the freedom to work on whatever languages or tools they need to work on. Let them do it their own way. But you standardize the outputs and the artifacts that you require. So you're expecting an EDA document, an exploratory data analysis document to be like this. Now, the data scientists can kind of figure out what tools they need to do to use to really get that analysis done. But you should standardize output, not the methodology, is what one more thing that I realized really works for leaders who are working with the data science teams. Suchit, are you there? I think I just...
I'm there.
Okay.
Great. So you want to continue on this?
One more point that I think is quite important is it's important for the leadership to really understand the limitations of machine learning. There is a lot of hype that is generated and a lot of expectations from the data science team where certain things that are believed to be solvable are not actually practical. And those expectations really need to be understood because if as a leader, you understand what expectations, what limitations a data science team has, the more you can, really understand what they're solving and how they're solving it. So that's one thing that I would really, really advise, that even from an intuitive perspective, you can ask your own team to sit with you once they build something and tell them, "Ki, boss, can you explain the whole model to me from an intuitive sense? How does it work step by step? How does the algorithm really work?" You can have that brainstorming session 2 or 3 hours after they deliver something. And that will kind of over time build your own intuition as a leader, even if you're not getting into the technical side of it. But it really helps while understanding, what machine learning and AI is about.
Awesome. I think the last point that you mentioned, that's probably the most important points for leadership, at least.
Yes.
Even from my experience, I've seen leaderships, they expect you to build something out of nothing. And this happens often in data science because data science is still very abstract in the industry right now and a lot of people don't get it.
Right.
If leadership doesn't invest in learning data science, it's a big mistake because they'll never understand what their people are trying to achieve. And probably one of the biggest mistakes that Akshay just pointed out is expecting things which are not possible from the team. You can't expect data scientists to come up with awesome analytics without any data. You're not collecting data, you can't expect the analyticians or the people in the analytics team to come up with the analysis without having any data. So as a leadership, you're the first person, you're the first point who should generate these ideologies and best practices in the company and start collecting data. So beautiful insight by Akshay. Akshay, moving on to the next one. Now, let's get a little technical. Okay, we talk a little technical out here. This is around NLP. Now, obviously, when I talk about NLP, I mean the only technical part of it is natural language processing. If you could explain things to the audiences in a very layman language and help us share how is NLP really changing the industry? So NLP, friends, is natural language processing. Akshay has been using it for quite a while and he's working in really cutting edge stuff right now. So Akshay, over to you.
Sure. So I think we can start off with the story of natural language processing in general. Like natural language processing is a very, very old field. Even before we were computing stuff with our processors, we were doing some stuff around the theoretical part of natural language processing. So it all started off with sets of words and their occurrences in sentences, right? Those were our understanding initially of how do you really represent a particular sentence. Later on, things like word embeddings and different methods for creating word vectors and all started coming up. And these helped us really embed contextual meaning into the sentences, right? So we're still talking about how do you represent data for a machine, right? What you do after that is a secondary thing. But being able to embed context and semantics into the sentence started off, say, 2000. It started off early as well, but the main breakthrough started coming around 2013 when the Word2Vec algorithm, the research paper, was released. And since then, I think we've seen a very, very high amount of research and progress done in the natural language processing field, especially around sequential models. Now, some of the core areas where sequential models are currently being used are with encoder-decoder architectures. These are used for machine translation. These are used for entity extraction. These are used for question answering. These are used for image captioning, where you input an image and into an encoder, and a decoder returns a sentence talking about what's there in the image. A lot of research was inspired and was created for these for building such sequential models. But at the same time, these architectures actually started moving into other fields of machine learning. For example, these encoder decoder architectures are now used a lot in anomaly detection. unsupervised anomaly detection. So there's something known as UNET, which is a combination of CNNs and a combination of encoder-decoder style architectures to detect anomalies and in an unsupervised manner in any form of data, right? Not just image process for image data or video data or natural language data. So a large amount of research which started off specifically to focus on how do we work with sequential information has started flowing into other types of data structures and inspired a large number of deep learning architectures that are now coming up. Now, recently, you would have heard that phrase that attention is all you need. There's a very famous phrase that that's been coined by some of the researchers who worked on something known as attention models. These models started very recently, where they started realizing that you don't have to really sequentially analyze or sequentially encode the whole data set. You can kind of look at the associations, semantic associations, and the attention that each word pays to other words in that particular sentence. And what ended up happening was that, for a very long time, for almost a year and a half or something like that, there was a massive boost in all the different algorithms and all the different use cases in terms of accuracy and the computation power also, there was a massive boost in that as well. Then in 2018, end of 2018, Google released the paper on BERT, which is a bidirectional recurrent transformer. So this was a pre-trained model that contained the required architecture to embed semantics and context. So you just download this particular model, you fine-tune the model with your use case with minimal amount of training, and now you have a state-of-the-art model that can understand and generate text, which is capable of human understanding, in certain cases better than human understanding as well. 1 week back, we had a research paper on ExcelNet, which has just bypassed BERT. So I think what I'm trying to say is that natural language processing today is one of those fields where a very large amount of research is going on. There is ample amount of data that we have on different problem statements, and there is ample amount of open source technology to work with it. I guess there is a lot of transformation that natural language processing has shown in terms of its algorithmic structures, but the core fundamental still remains the same, right? You're trying to emulate human speech, human textual information as much as possible, with context, with meaning behind it, with a purpose.
Awesome. So if I kind of rephrase it, it's not about being mathematically correct in every possible way. It's also about being contextually correct. So how do you understand the context of a particular statement? How do you respond to that context? And how do you sync with the human the way another human would have done? And that is what every research paper is trying to achieve. Right?
Absolutely.
So having said that, Akshay, I see you talked about a lot of different research that is going on. Okay. You see, companies are getting into the space right now. And with the tons of researches going on, with the tons of recommendations going on, it's just a little cloudy out there. So for a company starting afresh in data science, how would you make it easier for them to transition into data science? So what are your recommendations?
I would first recommend having somebody on board. So this is one mistake that startups make a lot. For a research field that requires a lot of domain knowledge, specifically because you don't have time to do research, right? You need to implement things, very complicated thing, complicated stuff very, very quickly. You require somebody who has a lot of industry experience, right? So the first thing I would suggest is for startups to really, really invest towards somebody who is an industry expert in the domain, because you would not have time to do research. You would not, even though you have very, very good junior resources who can spend a lot of time building models, very intelligent and very quick, can implement stuff very quickly. You do not have the time to really reinvent the wheel, right? So that's one of the first things. The second thing I would suggest is you need to find a way to balance out the research and the fast-paced delivery, right? That again boils down to the same thing. How do you really ensure that because of research, you never know when would you be able to really solve the problem, right? You can put timelines and time boxes, like Elon Musk has the methodology of solving research problems by setting an estimated time box. Now, when does that research start? He doesn't know. When does that end? He doesn't know. But he knows that if there are no other constraints, I might take at least 3 months or 5 months to solve this particular problem, right? So that time boxing is something that needs to be minimized as much as possible. Right, you're trying to minimize the amount of time for each particular component as much as possible without reinventing the wheel and really understanding what are the different solutions that are out there. The second thing is building models is not enough. You really need to go end to end. You need to have the capability to pull different types of work with different types of data architectures. You have to have the capability of implementing APIs very, very quickly to pull and push data. You have to be able to, of course, build models and deploy models very, very quickly. And you need to have some skill sets in really, really quick implementation of front end and UX for the client to either demo or to deploy. So it's an end-to-end life cycle that you need to invest towards, and not just data science. If you expect that I'll get the data, I'll build a model and show a POC, usually in my experience, clients don't really work with that. As long as they see something working in a front end, that's where you're really going to make an impact and see investments or projects coming towards you. And I think the last thing I would like to suggest is more specifically towards the business people who are responsible for selling some of these ideas. Of course, it's important that you understand the domain as much as possible. I understand there is a technology gap that is there, but you cannot really develop trust between your company and your client or your potential client by generating hype, right? You have to work towards showing actual skill, maybe doing POCs, showing capability, using the right words, because nowadays almost every company has their own data science teams, right? They're quite proficient in understanding when you are trying to use the fancy jargon and when you are actually talking about the stuff that really matters, right? So from that perspective, I would really, really advise companies who are getting into the domain to really invest in raw skill and making sure there is transparency in showing that raw skill with some practical output than using jargon and using keywords to kind of motivate people, because initially you might get some reaction from the clients, but it's not going to turn out anywhere unless until you really have the capability.
Awesome. So let's summarize it. First, invest in experts. You don't have to waste time reinventing the wheel. So 1 and 3 go ahead. Set time frames. Otherwise, data science is a research field, can go infinitely long. So if you don't have time frames in mind, do only that much that is possible in the time frame. Break it down into small units of work, get a time frame, get it up and running. And that's how you can achieve end goal. Otherwise, it's a never-ending process. Quick implementation of front-end demo required to convince your customers, because customers want to see some output. They're not interested in the algorithms. They're not interested in seeing what complex code you have written. They want to see something which is simple, abstract, and helps them solve the business problem. So they're interested in the output. So get the output in front of them ASAP. If you are in the sales side of the story, if you're trying to sell these products that your company is going to build, first is you've got to have understanding of the domain. You got to understand data science. Okay, domain and data science both have to go hand in hand. You should be able to talk in data science language, but simplified to English, which is a language that customers understand. So talking about POCs that your company has built to showcase your talent, your capability, this is what builds trust for the customers. And once you gain the trust of a customer, then selling that product isn't a big deal, right?
Perfect, yeah.
Okay, thank you, Akshay. So this was a very great insight by Akshay regarding companies. But follows companies, Akshay, is the next obvious question. How about me? So if I am... So I, as an individual, okay, I want to start my career in data science, and you talked about at the top, you should have some few people who are really experts, but you can also have raw talent who can be nurtured and
yes.
they can start creating products. So what do you tell for people like me who are starting their career in data science journey? So when I'm starting my data science journey, what is your recommendation?
So I think it starts with the majority of the changes that need to happen before you can really really get into the data science domain is more around your thought process. You need to be prepared to constantly study, right? You have to set time aside. Even today, after 7 years, I spend at least 4 to 5 hours every day studying, reading research papers, reading content, stuff that is coming up. So you have to be studying constantly. You cannot avoid that, irrespective of whether you're working on a job 9 hours or you're working part-time, doesn't matter. You have to study every day. That's the only way you can keep up with the field. So that's the first thing. The second thing is you have to stop thinking. If you say, for example, you're coming from a programming background, you have to stop thinking as a programmer, and you have to start what we call as a Pythonic thinking. Now, I'm sure different programming languages have their own style of thinking, but Pythonic thinking is something that you can read about a lot. It's a different type of thinking about. Put it simply, it's how a scientist or a mathematician would think when they're trying to program something, right? So your process or your way of thinking of how to tackle programming problems needs to change a lot. Of course, you do require, one of the biggest bottlenecks that I've seen, in people who are getting into the domain is programming. You have to be very comfortable with programming. That's one minimum requirement that is there, because you need to have the ability, even if you have a lot of theoretical knowledge about different models and different stuff, you cannot really do anything unless and until you have the ability to implement. So you have to be very, very comfortable with the programming language. And I think while, taking courses and certifications and other stuff is quite important because those are the ones that are going to give you theoretical knowledge. It's very important to participate in hackathons. It's very important to participate in problem solving. It's very important to spend some time on stuff like Stack Overflow, because that's where you get a lot of people who are asking questions and you have a chance to solve some of those problems, right? One of my favorite threads on Stack Overflow is the NumPy thread. Because people post very unique problems out there, that how do I transform my data from this particular data structure to this particular data structure. And these are very quick problems that you can spend like 15-20 minutes solving and then post an answer, and you might end up having the best solution. So it's more of a live problem solving activity that I enjoy doing most of the time. Your capability as somebody who is getting into the domain is purely dependent on how much you can show for, which means you need to have a good, strong GitHub profile. You need to be posting a lot of articles and stuff on Medium, for example. Written by Richard Feynman's philosophy was that if you teach somebody, you learn more than they learn, right? So that's very, very important in data science domain, because half the time, the amount of theoretical knowledge that you are consuming is so much that you yourself kind of skip through certain things. Even though you feel like you're learning stuff, you really skip through a majority of concepts. The best way to identify those areas and rectify those areas are when you start teaching other people about, I read this algorithm today, let me write an article about it, right? So this is, I think, something that is very, very important for somebody who really wants to get into the data science domain.
Awesome. So I noted down a few points, and friends, I hope all of you are capturing these important points. I mean, Akshay is probably sharing things that are worth, I can't put a price tag to it. These are very difficult to come across so easily. So Akshay has put it up in such succinct manner that it's so easy for me to understand. First things first, I need to change my thought process to be in data science. I have to think differently. I can't just think streamlined. Okay, so first is get your thought process in place. Second, you might be 10, 1 year experience, you might be a fresher, you might be a 40-year-old experienced person, 40-year experienced person, doesn't matter. You have to study every day. Data science is such a massive field. It keeps changing so fast. And if you don't keep yourself updated, you are left behind. So you have to keep reading, read a lot. You have to stop thinking like a programmer, but you also have to learn to program. So this is the most catchiest phrase which I found. Stop thinking like a programmer, but you still have to know how to program. Two reasons. One, if you are a programmer, you get deviated and you get diverted from your output, which is your end goal of achieving the business output, and you're interested in the programming output. You're trying to get optimized, you're trying to save memory, you're trying to save cost, but you're not saving the business. So you have to stop thinking like a programmer, think for the business. But you need to learn coding because nowadays tools are not as capable to support broader calculation. If we take Excel, for example, if I have 2 million rows of data, Excel will not help you because Excel is not there for you at 2 million rows of data. You would need some plugin. You'd need some extra third party to kind of sort it out for you. But end of the day, if you want to be the owner of your data and you want to have full control over, sorry, I think I just dropped off. Are you able to hear me?
Yeah, Sujit, I think I can hear you.
Okay, so let me continue from where I left. What Akshay mentioned was, if at all you want to be a data scientist, you should stop thinking like a programmer and think like a business person. But at the same time, you should be knowledgeable enough to code it out so that you are in control of the data right through. From the beginning till the end, you are in control. Okay. And then there were parts where you would want to kind of keep yourself updated by reading blogs. But at the same time, being updated isn't going to help you if you can't show other people that you are updated. The way in which you can show others you're updated is by having a beautiful GitHub repository where you can showcase your projects. Also, you can also write blogs on Medium. You can answer questions on Quora. This gives you visibility. This gives people the idea that, yes, so-and-so person is really capable in this space. So beautiful recommendation by Akshay. Let us move to the next question, which is, I think you already answered this. How do you stay updated with the latest trends? So you've got to read a lot of papers. You've got to keep yourself updated by scanning through tons of papers, tons of blogs, watching YouTube videos. It's a regular process. So you don't have to spend like every day you are going through millions of papers. Every day, make it a practice that you go through blogs, at least 2 blogs or 3 blogs, okay? Read through it. If you are that updated that you can understand papers, then you might want to just check up on the latest papers which are making a lot of noise out there in the market. Take a look at the papers and get a glimpse of what exactly the problem that the paper is trying to solve.
And
okay,
just to add, I think there's something I would like to add to this as well about how I ended up doing. I think most of the questions that people are asking right now are stuff like which blog and so on. There is no specific blog. What I essentially did was I've stopped using Facebook for social purposes. What I essentially have done is I've kind of blocked most of the stuff that is there on random stuff, and I've joined a lot of different groups on Facebook. Facebook is something that is, you know, is one of going to be one of those social platforms that is going to get a lot of information, updated information very, very quickly, right? So if you are not into that social media part, because I spend most of my time, you know, on LinkedIn, I use Facebook as my, you know, as my knowledge platform. Most of the 99% of the stuff that I get are articles and news articles about AI, machine learning. And you can find a large number of these groups just by Google searching. There are very popular groups that are there. Remove yourself from all other interest categories and put yourself on one of the popular social platforms only for, you know, using it as a data science news and knowledge tool for yourself. And I think that works for me. This is something that keeps me updated every time some new thing comes in, some new technology comes up. Facebook is one of the first places where it's going to be posted, right? Multiple people post about it, their blogs, their links to the research papers, everything is there. So just spending time using that, you know, searching through Facebook, just with respect to machine learning and data sciences, kind of is what I've done for the last, I think, 5-6 years now.
Awesome. So yeah, I think kill the apps that kill your time.
Yes. Okay,
so use them effectively. Do not get trapped because they are doing big time data science on you. So you are the customer here. You're not the person who's doing the job. So be the person who does the job. So be careful, friends. Try to accumulate more knowledge by wasting lesser time on social media platforms. Use these platforms for better things, something like log into different groups that help you learn better. How do you really figure it out yourself? Because Akshay, I'm pretty sure nobody gave you a point by point demonstration that Akshay, do X item now, do Y item now, join X group, join Y group. I'm pretty sure nobody handheld you into this, right?
There is no solution. There is no shortcut to it, unfortunately.
Yes, friends, please understand this. There's no shortcut to this. You have to venture out. You have to please go ahead and Google it out. Start researching. Don't expect Akshay to come up and tell you, see, this is one blog in Medium, which is awesome. You should read this. This is one first blog. This is the second blog. This is the third blog. Read as many and then figure out which one is good for you. There's no one right answer. So Akshay cannot give you one right answer. It's up to you guys to venture out, seek information, and then organize it. That's how you learn. Nobody gets handled into coding. Nobody gets handled into any industry. We have to work our way out. We'll give you the guiding light, but the work has to be done at your end. Thank you, Akshay, for that update. This is a question that I usually ask a lot of folks, though I know the answer and everybody knows the answer, just to kind of cement the idea. What is your take on job market in India for data science?
The job market is very, very good right now. You have a lot of startups that are coming on, solving multiple solved and unsolved AI problems in very unique ways. So there is a lot of opportunities. There is a lot of enterprises who are, kind of now setting up their own data science teams and investing very, very highly towards data science and machine learning capabilities internally as well. So the demand is a lot. The supply, when you start looking at it, is also pretty high, but it's very superficial. And this is the advantage that somebody who is really, really passionate about the domain, really is willing to spend time towards it. The quality supply is very, very limited. You do not really find a large number of people who are very passionate about the subject or invest or really, really spend their time working on data science the way it should be. So I think I would say that quality supply is missing and there is very high demand for it. Superficial supply is very, very high. So you will find every second person mentioning data science and machine learning algorithms in their resume. But after 10 minutes of talking to them, you really start understanding that it's more of more of a chore that they have done than just let's do this project, let's do that project. They would have not really done it with the passion that you expect out of a data scientist or somebody who's getting into that particular domain. So yeah, I think that's my
absolutely best. So being superficial, you may make it into the market right now. It's very easy to get into the market right now, but it'll not take you far. Also, companies are becoming mature, so they would expect depth in you. So please target for depth and not being superficial. Absolutely. Whatever you're doing, if it's something that can be done as a automated work, get out of it. Otherwise, your job is going to get killed in no time. So, friends, another important insight about how the job market is behaving in here and at India. So in India, definitely it's growing, but you also have to grow along with it and you have to grow faster than the market. Actually, moving to the next one, which is a very commonly asked question that people have, that I come from XYZ background. It could be coding, analytics, management, QA, and then like tons of such backgrounds. Mm-hmm. And I want to get into data science. Is it possible? And if it is possible, how?
Oh, it's possible. It's not very difficult to get into the domain. Backing the right type of job, I would not really comment on it because it depends on how capable you are and how much time you've put into it. But in terms of developing your own personal skill sets to really, bring yourself into the domain, I think I can think of four different things that you need to really focus on. The first and foremost being programming. You need to know one programming language very, 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 very well. You need to have an aptitude towards mathematics. and not all of the mathematics. You need to have some basic understanding of statistics, some basic understanding of probability, a lot of depth into linear algebra, some amount of understanding of calculus, very basic one. But I think focusing on these three or four different mathematics topics are going to be one very important part for you to really understand how those algorithms work and develop an intuition towards them. You need to focus on business knowledge. So if you are focusing towards a particular domain, for example, you're looking at the energy or oil industry, or you know, working for a particular specific industry like sales or marketing or retail, you need to really know the industry very, very well. And it's not very difficult to, you know, some amount of time in understanding how the, you know, supply chain model works and what are the core terminologies and what are the different variables that are tracked by managers, what are the KPIs. Just developing that understanding of the business for the ones that you want to work in is very, very important. And lastly, I would say that communication skill is very, very, very important. Communication skill is very important because as a data scientist, you are probably going to be an IC role guy, which is an individual contributor. Apart from your technical skill sets, you are expected to really handle the business directly. That business might be somebody who is, you know, who you are reporting to, somebody non-technical, or it might be a client if you're working for a services-based company. Therefore, it's very, very important that you really work on your communication skill of specifically around how do you communicate very complicated topics into an understanding for the client that they can use and they can be confident that you're working towards the right thing. So I think programming, mathematics, business knowledge, and communication skill are the four things that you really need to start working towards.
Awesome. So by definition, data science is a club of maths, programming, and business. But Akshay added the fourth dimension, which is communication. Definitely, if you can't communicate, absolutely, Nobody is willing to accept you. Yeah. So that goes without a saying. So this is an important point which we should have asked long back. But how is Reliance leveraging AI or ML?
Okay. There are a large number of teams in Reliance that are doing data science activities. Some of the teams, for example, the teams that are working in Jio are working with a large amount of data that comes in on a daily basis from the telecom stuff. There are teams in Hydrocarbons where I am associated, which work on plant data, sensor data. They're trying to predict, the probabilities of things going wrong based on, you know, sensors, how they behave, and looking at toxicity levels of the chemicals that are coming out. The domain that I work in specifically is around employee services. So handling all the AI and machine learning that is associated with learning management systems, assisting hiring managers, claims and reimbursement departments, policy departments, performance. So all the different virtual assistants and chatbots that have to be built, image processing for, you know, extracting information from bills and detecting whether some of these bills are containing information or, you know, blacklisted stuff which should not be reimbursed. So a lot of different problems, small problem statements, including stuff like cab booking stuff. So one of the cab booking services that matches employees with their cabs or matches the employees with other employees who are willing to do ride sharing. Building that, the route matching algorithm for that was something that my team worked on. So a lot of different domains, to be honest, and variety of data. But you can kind of look at any particular product that Reliance is building or any other company is building, for example, and really start seeing where AI and ML can be leveraged in multiple places.
So technically, if you have data, you're using data science in Reliance. Right? So that's across the board.
Sorry, Suchit, your voice just, can you just repeat that?
Yeah, so what I said was, if you have data and Reliance knows there's data in some place, they're using data science across the board.
Across the board, yes.
And just Reliance Jio.
Yes, and the advantage is that Reliance, of course, being a large company, has a lot of data, and my team specifically has 1.5 lakh customers on day one whenever we deploy something, because all the employees of Reliance are my customers. So because I work on employee services. So that's an advantage for me that, you know, on day one, I can start evaluating my models and how they're performing, and because they're released to a very large population.
Wow. So now coming back to individual profiles, what are the common resume mistakes you see?
There are multiple. I would say the first thing is, the most common thing that kind of frustrates me when I look at a resume is, that when you mention a particular model or a particular, data science keyword, right, you really, really need to have a background knowledge of it. Just implementing is not enough, because implementation of machine learning models is, a two line code, to be honest, nowadays, right? You really need to have a theoretical understanding of what you're doing. So I would really, really suggest that you, if you're writing something in your data science, related to data science in your resume, please make sure that you're very careful about what you write. Because somebody who is looking for some for a skilled data scientist is going to really pick that particular thing and get into depth. And the second they see that you are not in depth, you do not have in-depth knowledge for that particular thing, they're going to understand that most of the keywords probably, they're going to assume that most of the keywords that you mentioned in your resume are superficial. So that's one of the first things. Second is, it's not just about writing your keywords, it's also about what impact your models made. Because nowadays, almost every company gives you the time and the freedom to really explore different models if you're working as a data scientist. So I can kind of, in 3 months' time, I can work with 5 or 6 different models and I can write all of them on my resume. But that doesn't really mean that all those 5, 6 models really got implemented and made an impact, right? So it's very, very important that whatever you build, there is, you really show an impact, the impact that you created with it. One more thing that I really think is, while education is very, very important, you need to have good credentials in education. Being a new domain, data science kind of expects that you may not have as good an education, maybe you may not have a PhD or a master's degree, but you can kind of bypass that by showing a lot of capability and interest in the field by, really showing the type of courses that you have done, the grades that you got out of those certifications. You can show demo projects that you built in your free time. You can show results of your hackathon. You can share notebooks that you have built to really show your capability and your understanding of the domain. So, showing capability is a matter of not just writing the right keywords and writing the projects that you did, but also practical stuff that you do. And that to me is like, I would really, really think that if somebody comes to me and says that I have 0 years of experience, but these are the 20 different things that I've deployed across across in my free time during my college, I would say that boss, you are the right person for me. And that's really, really important, because it shows that how much passion that person has and how much time they want to really invest in the domain. You can kind of project and see that, if I give this person a particular project, then they would be able to handle it in the right way.
So let me summarize it. So if you have too many keywords on your resumes, please make sure you know it. And you know how to explain what value it created for you. Okay, so at the end of the day, if you can't justify what impact a particular model is making for your business, there's no point writing 5 models and not being able to explain which one did you use and why did you use. To show your passion, there are three things that definitely you would want to kind of portray on your resumes, which a lot of even experienced folks miss out. It's about what did you do to learn extra in this field? What extra step did you take? Did you go through courses? Did you do demo projects? Did you participate in hackathons? If yes, how did you kind of benefit from it? How did you solve the problem? How do you optimize the problem? Whatever work that you have done, have you showcased it? So something like if you have made a lot of notebooks, have you showcased it to the world by putting it up on GitHub? Have you written your understanding on blogs? Have you shared with the world that this is what I researched and this is what I found out? So it's not that you have to do it in your company project. It's not that the company has to get a client-approved project wherein you participate. It could also be your passion. If you can showcase your passion is oriented to data science, even people like even Akshay, if you have 0 years of experience in data science, he'll still consider looking at your resume and talking to you if you have something interesting to share. Right. So thanks a lot, Akshay, for that inputs. Coming to one very important question. If people are interested to apply in Reliance, so how do they find the relevant opportunities?
So most of the jobs that are job openings that are there, you know, for Reliance are available on LinkedIn jobs as well as are available on their portal, which is careers.ril.com. So you can kind of visit there, see what all openings are there. And hopefully if you get through and, you know, get selected, we might be working together.
Did I post it correct? Is this the link?
Yep, this is the link.
Okay, great. Friends, please have a look at this and you'll find a lot of relevant opportunities opening up, especially in a company like Reliance, who's growing left, right, center. And there's been a lot of news around what Reliance is doing in this field right now. So thank you, Akshay, for letting the audiences know what is the right way forward. Before we part off, I know we have taken a lot of your time. So before we part off for the day, what are your parting tips for people coming from different walks of life and getting into or planning the career in data science? So what would you say to start from today? So today to X number of days from today, what is your suggestion?
Have a daily schedule. First of all, of course, like I mentioned, you need to change your mindset. It needs to be very, very organized study patterns that you need to develop for yourself apart from work. This needs to be second nature to you, that when you come back from home or whatever free time you get, the information that you're getting is related to data science, the study and the time you're spending is related to data science. And it's not just specific to data science. You can kind of spend time on mathematics inspired fields. Like I watch a lot of playlists on YouTube that are associated with theoretical physics and amateur mathematics. There is nothing wrong with that because it's all going to come back in some form or the other, in some data science algorithm some way. So you need to really, force the content that is coming to you to be very specific to data science, automatically start showing in, your understanding for the field. You need to start really, really working towards practical implementation stuff that you can show for. You need to, day one, set up a GitHub profile. Day one, set up a Stack Overflow profile and start working with Python. Start, taking courses on Python if you're not if you do not have a programming background. But it needs to be an organized study towards the four things that I mentioned: programming, mathematics, business, and communication skill. And all of these, four things, there is enough material and all of it is open source that you can kind of pick up. So there is no dearth of, information. It's just about a very rigorous exercise. And, 3 months, you're going to see yourself as being somebody who has an understanding of the field. 6 months, you can kind of target yourself to, that I'll have five different blog posts on, five different algorithms. I will have competed in two different hackathons on Kaggle. So set targets, quantifiable targets for yourself, right? 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months. Within a year's time, I can guarantee you, if you're following something like this, you would be in the field, hands down. There's no doubt about that.
Awesome. So if I were to summarize, Akshay, it's all about practice, practice, and practice. Put in efforts every day. It need not be like Absolutely. You're working 14 hours a day and then studying for another 6 hours, then sleeping for 4 hours. It could be as less as 1.5 hours every day, and that should be a lot. I mean, 1.5 hours every day consistently is a huge amount of effort over a year. Akshay says he can guarantee that he would have transitioned. I think anybody can guarantee, because you yourself will realize after putting 1 month of dedicated effort how much you have learned. Okay, so this regular habit of reading, studying, practicing will get you there. So thank you, Akshay. That was awesome. I know we have crossed 12, and still there's one beautiful question from the audience. I'll only take one question. We are really short of time. We have actually exceeded time. So
sure.
So Akshay, you know, one final question.
Sure.
I have been practicing a lot. I have been applying a lot. I have been putting a lot of POCs on my GitHub, and I've written blogs on Medium. I'm still not getting noticed. So how do you address this?
That is quite surprising. Then you're not looking in the right forums. Being noticed, there are multiple ways you can kind of get noticed. One, you pick up one of the industry problems that a lot of people are solving. That is very popular, and you implement it. And write material about it. That's one of those things that you can kind of get noticed in. The other thing is you pick up certain research papers that you know some professors have solved, and you implement or build more research papers on top of that. That's another way of really really getting noticed. But if you have done all that, I don't see any reason why you would not be noticed. If you're posting on LinkedIn about what stuff you're doing, you're talking to other data scientists, you are going to conferences and meeting people, maybe that is something that you might invest time towards. That every year I go to 2 or 3 different conferences, because networking is very very important in this domain. I don't see any reason why being noticed would be difficult for you. If you have a strong data profile, you have practical stuff to show for, you have decent communication skills to really communicate your understanding for these models, I don't see any reason why anybody would not notice your capability in this domain.
Absolutely. So if you're sitting and only doing data science, good, but that'll not make you crack the space. That'll not give you entry into the field. You have to be proactive. You have to reach out to the right people. You have to keep a track of what is happening in the industry. Work on those things and let others also know that you're working on it. Put it up on LinkedIn. Share a project that you've done with everybody on LinkedIn. Your network should grow. If your network is not growing, you proactively reach out to people. And that's how we kind of build a network. So making the right network, reaching out to the right avenues, getting noticed is very easy. So thank you, Akshay. A big-hearted thank you from all of us. We are extremely glad that you spent your valuable Sunday morning with us, and you shared a lot of valuable insights. Going forward, friends, we are very glad to announce that Akshay is also a part of NSAID family now. So he's also going to mentor a lot of us. So it'll be great to work with you, Akshay, and a warm welcome to you in the NSAID family. And a big thank you for all of you. To all of you for participating today in spite of a busy Sunday. Thanks a lot, friends.
My pleasure, and thank you very much for having me. Thank you.
You may terminate the session.